All right, enough monologue here. For this week's regular portfolios, I spoke to Kevin, and I am cheating a little bit here because the man is an investment banker who he started his career with Bank of America Securities and later joined FTI Consulting. So he's not technically an outsider of the industry. Kevin is also a Wharton Business School graduate. So he pretty much went to school with people like Peter Lynch, Donald Trump, Elon Musk, Donald Trump's son. Well, not exactly, but you get the point. After completing that MBA that was right after the Great Recession, so he completed that in 2009, Kevin went to work for Cliffwater. Now, Cliffwater is it's an investment advisory firm that focuses on alternative investments, in this case, like think venture capital, private equity, and the likes. He did that for roughly 8 years and then got a position at the Clock Tower Group. That's another investment firm that focuses, in this case, it's macro strategies. And over there, he was responsible for the team that evaluated aspiring hedge fund managers. So basically, Kevin and his team will then decide if those hedge funds were worth Clock Tower's seed capital and efforts to help them with the launch of their new hedge funds then. He did that for roughly 3 years before deciding to start his own firm in 2020. So that's exciting. And I'll probably have a link somewhere for you to find out more about his firm if you're really interested. Kevin now lives with his wife. I was about to say beautiful wife to add some drama to my story here, but I realized I've never seen her. But let's just assume she's beautiful for the time being. And he's also got two beautiful kids who I also haven't seen. But you get the point. They live in California. And when I asked him how he invests his money, though, he told me he had to take a step back. And he gave me an interesting technical explanation how one should approach their portfolio. So let's play that clip on here.
Yeah, so let me just take a step back and kind of give you a little bit more perspective on kind of looking at markets and macro investing and some lessons learned from prior roles, especially that role at Clock Tower and currently. So I think it's discretionary global macro investing. So basically betting on the direction of markets based on discrete events. So like a political election or central bank policy action or something like that. It's really, really difficult. And so if you think about it from an efficient markets perspective, let's just talk about central bank policy for a second. So, rates markets and currency markets are so liquid and so heavily followed by so many sophisticated investors around the world. If you're trying to make a bet on, well, I think the Fed is going to be more dovish, or I think the Fed is going to pivot, at a certain point. And so therefore I'm going to go long duration, ahead of that pivot. That type of bet is really, really challenging. I think to make alpha or to generate value over time by making that sort of bet, just because those central bank actions and political outcomes and things like that are so closely followed by so many investors in those markets, generally actually are pretty liquid in the short term. Now, I'm not saying markets are efficient all the time, but I just think it's very difficult to make those types of bets. Another area that a lot of macro investors try to focus on is polling. So they say, well, you know, the polling suggests that this particular candidate is going to win. So, you know, like where there's an election in Brazil right now. So, Lula will win over the other competitor. Polling is a difficult game to play as well, because of one of two outcomes. Either the polls are wrong or unreliable, or if the polls are reliable, everybody knows what they say, so they're already priced into the market. So I don't try to make those kind of high level directional bets. That being said, I am macro aware, and I am cognizant of cycles, and that's drawn me to commodities over the past couple years. So long way of saying that I am focused heavily on commodities. I do like areas, as I said before, that I think are dislocated or misunderstood by markets. And so there are certain commodity stories, including uranium, but also others, that I think are still not widely understood by the broader investing community in terms of supply demand dynamics. So my personal investing, I try to align it with what I'm encouraging my clients to do. So there is alignment of interest, as I can say that I'm kind of eating my own cooking. But my portfolio, but I don't day trade. I don't try to time these macro events. And it's more, I would say, kind of medium term theme based investing, that's aligned with clients. So that's kind of a high level answer, I'll let you ask a question to dig more on that.
Sure. I'm just thinking, if you're focusing on commodities, you're approaching this in a very sophisticated way, it seems to me. You're not like me. Just what I did is, oh, commodity super cycle. Sure, let's just plow 100% into commodities. What I did. What percentage of your portfolio have you put into commodities?
Yeah, so I would say it's about 60% of my personal. So let me just distinguish between kind of client aligned or less liquid portfolios and liquid portfolio and liquid investments.
For sure, investment. We're talking about you specifically in this case.
Yeah, right. So in terms of the liquid portfolio, it's about 50-60% commodities. I'll dig more into that in a second. But the remainder is I have a convertible bond allocation. I think there's a dislocated convertible bond opportunity where a lot of these convertible bonds are basically money good, actually pretty high in terms of credit quality compared to high yield. And so I think there's definitely a dislocation there. And then I have a few Chinese stock investments. Alibaba is one example. I think that stock is just ridiculous, not ridiculously, but it's been beaten down significantly this year. And that this is a really, really high quality business fundamentally. And the sort of cloud computing division of Alibaba alone is very similar to Amazon's AWS division. And that alone is probably worth more than the current market cap of the overall Alibaba tradable shares. So I think that's a fundamentally really strong investment. That combined with the fact that China will probably reopen soon. A lot of people have been sort of, it's a fool's errand to try to predict exactly when China will reopen, but it probably will happen sometime over the next 6 months, maybe sooner. It might happen after the Party Congress when Xi Jinping is anointed to his third term or term for life or whatever they call it. But that opening up will likely serve as a tailwind for Chinese stocks overall. So Alibaba is my biggest position in that theme. And then I have some hedges and some other sort of random, fundamental stock investments, kind of quality plays. Within commodities, as I said before, that's about 56-60% of that liquid portfolio. Let's call it 60%. Of that, it's about half uranium, and the other half is a combination of oil, coal, and natural gas. So that's a short answer.
Okay. I wish I could say the same about oil and natural gas. My other half is gold, silver, and copper, as I'm shaking my head. How do you diversify within the commodities? What are you focusing on? Are you going for the crapshoots, sort of explorers, green fields, brown fields, or are you mostly focusing on companies that already have cash flow?
Yeah, so first, I do want to increase my exposure to gold and silver. Coal, I'm more hesitant on just because of recession risk. Which I can talk. That's also a risk for oil. Clearly, the supply demand story is first of all, it's less opaque than uranium. It's pretty. Easy to not easy. Well, yeah, it's pretty straightforward, I'll say, to assess the supply demand story in oil. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of bullish signals right now. So first of all, the SPR release is ending this month. I don't think I'm not betting on this, but I don't think that the Russia-Ukraine conflict is going to have a clean end anytime soon. So there's going to be that tailwind. Russian oil somewhere between 1.5 and 2 million barrels will definitely be taken off the market at the end of this year. And then, of course, there was the OPEC cut that was greater than expected. And a lack of CapEx in the shale producing regions in the U.S. and Canada, especially the U.S. And so all those things, are a tailwind for on the supply side. And then the demand side, China reopening is a huge story there. That, as I said before, though, that, I am a little bit cautious about sort of this potential deep recession risk that the ongoing energy crisis in especially in Europe causes this deep recession, which will adversely affect demand for oil. But I think for the foreseeable future, I call it the end of this year, everything is kind of stacked up for a higher oil price as we're seeing now. So within oil, I do have some call spreads. within sort of options and futures. And then I have a few positions in producers that are just trading at that are cash flowing producers. They're trading at ridiculously low valuations. And I haven't done a lot of fundamental work. I've kind of leveraged the work of some other folks, like Andy from Finding Value, actually has been very helpful with this type of work. And then also the Goldman Sachs commodities desk, I get their research. Those are both really valuable sources. So I invest in, like, Crew is an example of a position in that category. Nat gas is it's a smaller exposure right now. I'm looking to increase it. Right now it's more options on futures. I don't have any producers in my portfolio right now. But that's not the Nat gas story is a, you know, again, European energy kind of chaos story. And then Nat gas has a, unlike some of these other commodities, has a very diverse use of sources. So it's not just for like burning for electricity, but also has a lot of industrial sources and things like fertilizer that I think are maybe underappreciated. Now uranium, I've spent, you know, I'm fascinated by the story. I've spent probably way too much time on it relative to other things. I've leveraged the work of your channel. Actually, you have a lot of great information on it, Justin Hewen from Uranium Insider, and then some more I'll call it institutional quality institutional sources. Not that. So just one of the interesting things, just as an aside, is that I think there's been a narrowing of quality of research between the Goldman Sachs of the world, so the institutional providers of research, and the quote retail providers of research. So I think like the Uranium Insider reports, and you know, a lot of your content and a lot of other sort of YouTube or Twitter related, John Quakes' Twitter profile. It's just as high quality research as what Goldman Sachs produces, frankly. But for a lot, you know, either free or a lot less cost. There's a lot of resources here. So within uranium, I am fascinated by the story. In terms of my own personal portfolio, I have a combination of physical uranium through the Sprott Physical Uranium Trust. I have a position in Cameco. I've avoided Kazatomprom for now just because of the country risk, and I don't know what Russia's going to do. So I know it's cheap, but I don't want to take that risk right now. And then I have some sort of near-term developers, so things like Global Atomic, for example, and Denison. I have avoided the explorers that are just kind of poking holes in the ground. I just, you know, who knows? I don't really have time to look at, and I'm not a nuclear engineer. I don't have time to look at you know, extensive drill results and things like that. One other caveat is that in that middle category, that sort of near term producers or advanced stage developers, I am cognizant that you know, a lot of these uranium experts and retail investors are all trying to chase the next Paladin Energy, but these companies are not trading at, you know, the low valuations that Paladin was during that sort of historic 100,000% win. So they're not that cheap anymore, but the uranium price clearly has to go up, and that will you know, probably in the near term, and that will clearly be a tailwind for the overall sector. The last thing I'll note is that you know, I have spent some time understanding the fuel cycle, as I know you're quite familiar with, and so this idea that the SWU and the later stages of the fuel cycle, those prices are way up compared to spot. I mean, that has to filter down. It's just only a matter of time. And then I'll quote something that, you know, I think you're familiar with, Per Gander from WMC Energy which I thought was really important on the recent Uranium 5.0 conference that was hosted by Bloor Street. So he noted that if he was asked to buy 1 million pounds of uranium in the market today, he probably couldn't, but if he could source it, it would raise the price by $5 in a day. And the spread, you know, so that's really, really telling that this thing is about to explode pretty soon. I mean, it's hard to know exactly when, but that's why I really like, those are all the reasons I really like that story.
Mm. When you say explode, what are you hoping for? Like, what would you like your uranium portfolio to return for you to be able to turn around in a couple of years and think like, hey, this bet was worth it. You know, it was up and down. It was emotional. I didn't really understand it most of the time. That's how I feel, but it was worth it. What percentage would that be?
Well, so I probably wouldn't think about really meaningfully reducing exposure until the spot price hits around 100. You know, I've heard the calls for, you know, from smart people for like for $500 an ounce. I mean, it's possible. I think 200 is more likely. And then, you know, that the air comes out of the balloon a little bit. But 100 is certainly, you know, a very possible scenario before there's any kind of meaningful production coming online. And then the next leg of the trade is, well, let's say we hit those $900 an ounce, and then these producing, you know, near producing mines like Denison start to really get on board and start to really build out their plans to produce. Then we're at a, well, how much is this actually going to cost, and how long will it take? How long will it take to source engineers? What's the inflation story look like at that point? You know, how much, like, is it hard to find sulfuric acid and other necessary components like that to actually run the mines? And so all that is, I think, probably going to result in an even more elongated cycle towards production for the mines that are on care and maintenance or not producing at all right now. So that's kind of what I'm thinking in terms of spot price. In terms of the underlying equities, the other thing to be a little bit careful of is dilution. And you have to consider dilution and not just blindly compare the share prices in the last cycle to potential share prices in this cycle. But what I try to do, and it's obviously more difficult, but what I try to do is compare market caps during the last cycle to market caps during this cycle. And companies like Denison are still way below the market cap in the last cycle, with more pounds on the ground and probably a more sustainable, robust cycle this time. And you know, as you know, and as people should be reminded, there was not a supply deficit in the last cycle, and not the kind of nuclear renaissance, especially in Asia, that there is now during the last cycle. So the cycle will look different. But it's a little bit more of a nuanced comparison. So just to put put some numbers on it. So for Sprott, I'm looking for like a 2x, you know, assuming that it's near NAV, the spot price around 50 now. So 50 to 100, that's 2x. For the other equities, you know, 3 to 5x. I do have experience with derivatives as well. So I do have some call spreads on, and a couple of actually just kind of directional calls. So those, you know, should be more like 10x, but those are more just smaller positions.
Okay, time for me to pull out the gun then, and I ask you the gun to your head scenario, which is, if you had to sell everything and only hold 3 stocks for the rest of this uranium bull cycle, the rest of this commodity cycle, which stocks would you keep? Is it all the uranium? What are we looking at?
Yeah, so I would keep Global Atomic for sure. I would probably keep BTU. The ticker is Peabody, and that's it depends on how you define commodity cycle, I guess. But I guess through the winter, I think that company, you know, is still very cheap. And Europe is unfortunately going to be burning a lot more coal this winter. So and then there's also a few sort of corporate actions. It looks like they're going to return a lot of money to in terms of buybacks or dividends, or so there are going to be some corporate actions that will lift that stock before the end of the year. So BTU, and then maybe Bannerman, you know, as more of a moonshot. I have a lot of confidence in Brandon Monroe, and I know it's a higher cost producer, but that one I think has a lot of potential upside.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. BTU has a 30% levered free cash flow yield. So there's that.
Right. Yeah. And right. And, you know, so these companies are returning, you know, like just in cash flows, the value of the company within 2 to 3 years. And then I don't know off the top of my head what the dividend payout ratio on that one is. But yeah, it's very cheap.
Good stuff. What would you like to leave the the audience with? Like, if you, I like putting it that way, but if you could go back in time and give yourself just one very short advice, and if that advice is not buy Bitcoin at a dollar, what else would that advice be?
maintain dry powder.
How much?
You know, for these dislocations. So, I would say at least 20%. Remain hedged is the other. Even a small hedge, it is a drag on the portfolio during most times. And some people wouldn't be comfortable hedging at all or using derivatives. But in periods like March 2020, it just gives you a lot more capacity to be aggressive and really, you know, buy when others are fearful. Along those lines, I think it's be very aware of your own personality and your own biases. And so it's very easy to say, oh yeah, buy when others are fearful, but when it's actually happening, when everybody's getting sick and dying of COVID or whatever, even though it really has a limited impact on the kind of the steady state economy, or that medical event did, it's also really hard to get aggressive during a time of fear like that. So it's easier said than done. And I would say it's as I'll just borrow. I think several people have said this, but it's much easier to talk about a commodity bull market than live one. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's important to kind of build conviction, do deep research, know your own comfort level with your risk level and your own biases and kind of invest accordingly and be patient.